So this is probably the best speaker you're going to hear all semester. How about that for a setup, Kareen? Give it up for Kareen. Kareen's here. You have no idea how amazing this woman is. She's a good friend of mine. She's like the Forrest Gump of Utah Tech. She's been everywhere. Just an amazing woman, my hero. Please welcome Kareen Clark.
This is Clint. He's the only person on the planet. Whenever he asks me to do something, I say yes. So he really is the brains behind Silicon Slopes and Beehive Startup. And he's that quiet guy that kind of sits in the background, but actually has tremendous power. So I'm so delighted to be here. I'm kind of fighting a cough, so I'm gonna try to do mind over matter. And I mixed a bunch of cough medicine and cold medicine, so if I start to get stupid, it's because I did the stupid thing and did that. But I want to make sure that we had some fun today. So I'm gonna talk to you about risk and disruption. I'm gonna talk to you, and I'm gonna challenge you a little bit, because I work with a ton of students, so I work with a ton of entrepreneurs, and we do things to ourselves that limit us, that stop us from doing unbelievable things. And I am the Forrest Gump of the tech industry in Utah, because I'm no one in particular, but I'm in every picture with all these famous people. And they're like, who's that fat girl with the big hair? It's like, it's always me. So I actually had a job that considering, and they asked me for some references, and so I gave them a bunch of famous people, and they're like, who are you? I said, I'm Forrest Gump. I'm no one in particular, but everybody knows who I am, and it's probably because I'm old. So let's talk about risk. Let's talk about your own posture for risk. So why are we so afraid? Why are we so afraid to take challenges? Why are we so afraid to do things that are different? Why are we so uncomfortable with risk? And when I ask students, they say, well, it's because it's risky, that's why. It's like when you say, what does salt taste like? Well, it's salty. Well, we're afraid of risk because it's risky. And I would say that we're afraid of risk because we have a negative view on what risk really means. And so today I'm going to try to get you to think about how we should look at it differently. I mentioned I work with a lot of entrepreneurs. It's a fabulous job to be able to spend time with bright, young, capable people. And you know what? Entrepreneurs are not less risk averse. So the research would say they're not less risk averse. We think they are. We think they're like, oh, no big deal. I'll lose my house and my car and my children's future so that I can build something really stupid. They're not less risk averse. They just look at risk differently. They look at risk the way I'm going to share with you today. So what if we looked at the world differently, and what if we decided that we would always ask ourselves, what's the worst thing that could happen? And that we challenged ourselves a bit, and we were okay with being a little uncomfortable. I want you to think about, how do you talk to yourself? What are the things that that voice says to you? So we all have that voice, and we all have this thing I call our corduroy, when it gets rubbed a certain way and you're like, yeah, I'm not okay with that. What if we change the way we perceived risk? So a lot of us see risk this way. It's like this Rubicon. It's this dangerous edge. It's this awful cliff. And it's scary. What if it wasn't scary? What if we decided that we were going to embrace disruption, that we were going to embrace change? I have two sons, and one of my sons, my younger son, hates change. Like, he will not wear anything the first time. You see a problem with this? If you're 14 years old and 240 pounds. Like, the clothes you had when you were 5 don't fit, right? Even though it's your favorite. So I resort to cutting off tags and lying. Are these new pants? I don't know, right? Because he doesn't like to wear anything the first time, but that's ridiculous. And so I tell him, the only thing that's not going to change is that everything's going to change all the time. So working with him about being uncomfortable in that brand new pair of pants that are the exact same pants, just one size bigger. Working with him and teaching him, what does it mean to be resilient? Think about when you were the most uncomfortable when you were a little feller, little person. I have two for me. Kindergarten, dude would not relive that day. Because I was at home with my mom, nap, all kinds of yummy treats, and now I'm with strangers, right? I hated the first day of kindergarten. Also hated the first day of high school. I thought everybody was way cooler than I was. I survived those days. Guess what? Now my least favorite thing, first day on a job. Hate being the new guy. But look at the changes. I'm so glad I'm not still in kindergarten because those are not my people anymore, right? I'm so glad I'm not in high school anymore. I would never go back to high school. I don't love being the new guy on the job, but it gives you a chance to have a brand new start. So think about, what if we looked at it differently? So I'm going to share with you some synonyms to risk that I want you to consider. What if we looked at risk as an adventure? What if we said, this is a new opportunity for me? I am going to be open to this world. So this summer, one of my dreams was to take my family to Eastern Africa. And you got to have a really good job to do that, so y'all should stay in school so you have a really good job so you can do this someday. Because by the time you get to Africa, the elephant population will be almost gone, unfortunately. And so we planned it as a family. We were going to do 3 weeks. And everyone said to me, have you lost your mind? Like, they eat people there. I'm like, who eats people there? They're like lions and stuff. I'm like, okay, that's weird. It's dangerous. There's like tribes. Like, the Maasai will kidnap you and give you for ransom. I'm like, where does this all come from? My mother's like, will you please text me every day so that I know you're not dead? I'm like, okay, well, no. No Wi-Fi there. Oh my gosh, that's it right there. That's the reason not to go to Africa. It was true, no Wi-Fi. I did bring a satellite phone, but the problem with bringing a satellite phone to Africa is what? You have to use it outside, right? In an open field. Where stuff eats you. And monkeys take your phone. So I couldn't use a satellite phone. We went to Africa. It was the grandest adventure we had ever been on. We traveled out of one bag. We stayed in jeeps. We stayed at some pretty nice resorts. But we saw unbelievable things that we would not have seen otherwise. And it was the greatest adventure we had ever been. We still talk about it. And what if we had not done it because we were afraid? So for me, I'm a student, and there's a lesson in everything for me. We're not born afraid, by the way. There are forces that are pushing on us. Fear of failure and pressure to succeed. Okay, those are real. And so you're always going to be dealing with this. It's just because in society, it's accepted to be afraid to fail. Think about it. Someone, you say, oh, I really want to do that. I really want to ask this girl out. Oh, dude, like she's too good for you. Oh, yeah, I'm not going to do it. I'm afraid. Okay, I totally get that, right? We do this to each other. We enable each other to be afraid. And it's socially acceptable. In reality, fear of failing is ridiculous because we learn more from our failures, really, than from any of our successes. And we are raised to learn about failure. My evidence, two examples. One, the school spelling bee, right? There's only going to be one winner. And for that one guy to win, everybody else has to fail. I love the Brian Regan bit. It totally spoke to me. When he's like, okay, spelling bee, take me, cat, K-A-T, I'm out. Going to read another book, right? It's like a relief to get out. Failure. Second example. Musical chairs, right? There's a loser every round. And it's embarrassing. It's like, oh, dude, you lost. Not a chair for you. My younger son, who I love and adore, when he was little, we were playing musical chairs. Not my idea. I hate that game. But he said, Mom, dude, if you could get us another chair, we could play this for hours. He's right, right? Music stops. Everybody gets in a different chair. Ah, it's hilarious. A child figured out the real fun of musical chairs is you get to sit next to a new person every time. And you might fall off the chair. And so we learned this. We've adapted to this. Okay, so what if we embraced failure as a gift? What if we decided that I'm going to learn more from my mistakes than from any of my successes? And every time you have something disruptive happen to you, when that corduroy gets rubbed the wrong way, your brain changes to say, what can I learn from this? So this is where we are today, two cliffs. You're on this side, safe, you're on solid ground. And you think, okay, the other side is cooler, it's got nice grass, and there might be a whole other world over there. But I'm happy where I'm at. Because better to know what you've got than to try something else. I would say this is going to stop you. You're never going to be more than you are today. You have to be willing to take that step. And we think this is like a running leap, when in reality, it's just one step where you could straddle the whole cliff. But a lot of us don't take those chances. For me, this cliff, I was at Novell for almost 15 years. I loved my job there. I worked with every single CEO except for the last one. And I had worked my way through marketing. I grew up in that company. And when Eric Schmidt was the CEO, he said, I do believe you're going to be the one to turn the lights off here. And I took that as a compliment. Well, guess what? I lost my job after almost 15 years. Highly ranked position, female executive, because there was new ownership and they wanted to change things. And it was terrifying for me because this is where I'm supposed to be. I know where the restrooms are. I know where all the snacks are. I know every human, right? This is safe. Oh, and by the way, I was 6 months pregnant with triplets. Only one survived. So it was already this really tough time. I had no debt, so it's not like I couldn't survive. And when I came home and told my family, I'm not going to be there anymore. My son at the time, my older son, said, are we going to have enough to eat? I thought to myself, I've done a bad job of managing risk for this family. So guess what? When you're forced with that kind of disruption and change, you can either curl up in a ball and sob uncontrollably and go get a paper route, or you can pop your head up and say, hey, I've got some mad skills. I'm going to see what else is out there. Well, guess what? Utah is a very entrepreneurial state, and there's a ton of jobs out there. So it was this little tiny startup called Altiris. Little tiny, hadn't gone public, had a really interesting product, but they didn't market it well because they're like, we solve your systems management problems. Well, no one goes to bed at night and says, oh, I got systems management problems. So I could help them. So I had a bunch of different job offers. I took a job with them for a lot less pay, for no title, for no staff, for no budget. My husband's like, have you lost your mind? I'm like, no, I knew what I could do for them. Ended up being a springboard for me to do many, many, many other things. So I, through that, became the chief marketing officer at Symantec, which at the time was the second largest software company in the world. Had a massive budget, massive team. And then from that, went to two other CEO positions. All from that one day of disruption that felt like it was the end of the world. Because we can't see that. So what if we didn't make fear a person? Because it has a life. We give it life. We feed it. It lives with us. What if we said, stop. You're not helpful. I'm not going to do that anymore. Now, is fear helpful? Yes. I'm walking here from this parking lot today, and there are students who've got to get to class. If I'm not paying attention, I'm going to be killed, right? So that kind of fear, good. But don't be foolish, be smart, be aware. And don't let fear determine your fate. So if you're sitting there thinking, oh yeah, I'm totally good, I never do that, I'll say you're lying. We do this to ourselves. I want to ask her out. Nope, can't do it. Okay, we just let fear determine your fate. I'm miserable, I hate my part-time job. If you don't change, you just let fear determine your fate. If you let fear stop you from doing something that you really want to do, you've just let fear determine your fate. Do you remember the Indiana Jones movie, The Last Crusade? That movie spoke to me. When he's trying to save his father's life, and he walks out to that abyss, and it looks like, oh, I'm going to have to leap to my death. And he has to have faith, and he takes one step, and there's this plank that he can't see, that he can actually run across. He didn't see it. His lens wasn't correct. We do that to ourselves. We let fear determine our fate. If he hadn't taken that step, his father would have died. Instead, he had this grand adventure, and we got a great movie out of it. So pay attention to how that fear feels inside of you, right? And change it. Don't let it stop you. Pay attention to it. What if we looked at risk as a chance, as the possibility of something happening? What if we decided that we were going to remove fear from our life and we were going to be super resilient? That we were going to bounce back, that we were going to figure things out. Unfortunately, a lot of people take that fear and give it a life, and then they try to bury it, walk around it, go over it, pretend like it's not there, but it just gets bigger and bigger. They'd rather not deal with it and stay in their comfort zone, which they know really well, instead of change. So if you look at disruption and the changes in your life as growth, I bet you'll do things differently. You say, look, I'm not afraid to grow, and I'm not afraid to fail, because I will learn more from my failures than from anything else. Because we see bright, capable, competent people who stop themselves. So stop stopping yourself. If you want to start a company, build a plan. If you want to change your station, change your job, change your relationship, take control of it and say, look, if I have a vision and a plan, I can do anything. Because that's what I do. No matter what happens to me, if I have a vision and a plan, I can do anything. And the other thing that I changed for myself is that if you decide today that nothing is hard for you, do you know what happens? Nothing will be hard for you. Because if you've already decided nothing's hard for me, because guess what? We all have hard things. Every one of us has hard things. But if you decide nothing's hard for me, then I promise you nothing will be hard for you. Because your lens will change and your brain will start to figure out how you can unpack these problems and how you can solve really complex, awful things. Okay, I love this image because this little fish who's stuck in this little tiny bowl is brave enough to throw himself into that bigger bowl. He's willing to take the chance. He sees the opportunity for a much bigger world for him. In my world, there's a really good-looking fish in that other bowl who's now my best friend. But most people, when they look at that, they're like, he's not gonna make it, he's gonna die. Well, I'd rather die than live in that little itty-bitty bowl. Too many times, we overestimate the risk and we underestimate our ability to solve the problem. We underestimate our ability to manage the risk. We underestimate our ability to figure something out. And sometimes we get lazy, okay? So anyone knows me, they know that 1,845 days ago, I was diagnosed with cancer, ovarian cancer, awful cancer, 20% survival rate. And when you have no cancer in your family, and you're at the top of your career, and you've worked for 22 years to get two dudes on the planet, and they say to you, you have cancer, and you're not likely to survive. That's kind of disruptive, okay? That's like the most disruptive thing anyone can say to you, other than your spouse has died or your child has died, right? So I'll put it right up there. And so because I had decided that nothing was hard for me, guess what? It wasn't hard for me, and I survived. So you might say, well, she survived because she's lucky. Okay, I don't believe in luck. I believe that luck favors the prepared, that luck favors the determined, people that never give up. And so I did 18 months of chemo. I did 6 months of weekly chemo. That's not for sissies, right? And so every time they came to me and said, we have this problem, the medicine's not working, you had a heart attack, I'm like, hey, nothing's hard for me. And my doctor was like, she's crazy. But my oncologist, who's now one of my best friends, said, you know what? Because you always said that nothing was hard for you, we believed you and we pushed you. And we all knew that you were going to survive because we had a responsibility to make sure you survived because you believed it. And we believed that nothing was hard for you. And we tell that to other patients and they're like, yeah, everything's hard for me. And they're like, yeah, you're not going to make it. Unfortunately. Because we do have control of how we respond to things. We do have control of how our corduroy gets moved, right? We don't have control of stuff that happens to us. I didn't have control of cancer. But guess what? The cancer taught me more than you could ever imagine. And people are like, right, cancer sucks. Yes, it does. There was nothing I could do but move through it and be great about it. Because I have two kids. And I wanted my two sons to know that they're going to have hard things. And I wanted to show them, this is what you do. This is how this family rolls. And when you decide that nothing is hard for you, then nothing is hard for you. I learned a ton. I learned that I'm a lot tougher than I knew. My husband's like, yeah, we all kind of knew that, but it's good. I learned that people are good. I learned that cancer ended up being a gift to me because it made me decide to do things like go to Africa. It made me decide to do things to take 21 people to Normandy so that my father could go to his father's grave, who died in World War II, and he could be there with all of his grandsons, except for my one son who was on a mission. but he could be there and tell the story of this man before my father died. So if you never try, you'll never know. You'll never know. And to me, regret is worse than failure, because failure is a gift, because you will learn things. It will change you. What are you doing to get outside your comfort zone? What are you doing to start doing things that are a little uncomfortable? When I talked to my husband, he's like, yeah, I don't like to be uncomfortable. It's like, well, look at it as an opportunity to do and try and be new things. It's a good thing I graduated from kindergarten, because I would have been an awful kindergartner forever, right? It's a good thing I moved on. It's a good thing I graduated from high school, because I hated my high school years. I do much better as a grown-up. I couldn't do high school. I went to high school in Germany, and I was this tall, so it was like really a no bueno thing. But think about, what are you doing to push yourself outside of your comfort zone? I got my ham radio license. That is a ridiculous thing. But my whole life, I was concerned that if the satellites went down, I couldn't communicate. And since I'm attached to my cell phone, I needed a way to communicate with my father and my brothers. So I said, hey, because the zombie apocalypse is on us, let's all get our ham radio license. And my brother's like, you're crazy. So I studied on all my flights, and I went and took the test. And when I went to take the test, I didn't know what classroom it was in. So I was like, none of these are my people. I have no connection with these people. And I couldn't figure out where the classroom was. I was like, watch for the dudes with like 12 things hanging off their belt. Those are the people. Watch for the cars that have the big antennas with all the junk in the back seat. Those are the people. So I stayed in the parking lot, and I found those people. And so I followed them into the testing place, which was at the BYU Law Library. And I went in there, and they're like, oh no, litigation studies is that way. I'm like, no, ham radio operator potential. So I went in there, took the test, got my license. KF7ZSX, if you ever want to talk to me. And everybody thinks it's ridiculous, but my dad got his license. My dad's 75 years old, and he got his next license. He has the highest certification for ham radio. And he talks to a dude in New Zealand every weekend. So this thing that pushed me out of my comfort zone actually created this really fun thing for my father, who I need his brain to be active, because I need him to be on this planet. Now, my father's a retired colonel, 30 years in the Army, this great, great man. And now he has a hobby that he never would have had. And so I don't take credit for it, but I recognize that by me pushing myself outside of my comfort zone to be with people that are not usually my people, who have a lot of things hanging off their belt and a lot of junk in the backseat of their car, it's a fun thing. Last year, I worked with a lot of folks that are bikers. None of this screams that I can actually be a biker, right? But I thought, so, you know, I'm gonna sign up for a race. I'm gonna get a nice kit, I'm gonna get a nice bike, and I'm gonna sign up for a race. So I signed up for a 70-mile race. And everyone's like, that is a ridiculous first race. Like, why don't you do like 10? No, I signed up for 70. So I trained, and my guys were so great, because even though I don't look like a biker, they pretended like I did, right? They would ride with me, and I never missed a mile. So I did this race called Goldilocks in September. And I was so excited, because I had worked so hard. And I just wanted to finish, because it was important to me to do something that was outside of my comfort zone. So I started the race, and I was like, right out of the gate, I am dominating this. I don't look good, but I feel good. And then I realized I'm riding in traffic. I've never trained in traffic. I only trained on a trail. Lots of loose gravel. I had a flat tire at mile 11. I'm like, I don't know what to do with a flat tire, because I have people that just take care of it for me. So there was a nice guy on the race help me. So I'm like, okay, I've had my flat tire, it's all good. Mile 22, another flat tire. I'm like, what is going on? Bunch of nice guys helped me. I was like, okay. Mile 32, third flat tire. I was like, I am gonna bawl, because I'm doing something wrong. And the race team said, we don't think you're doing something wrong, but we're gonna have the race marshal follow you, because we've never had this many flat tires. And I'm like, I'm sure I'm doing something wrong. I wasn't doing anything wrong, it just happens. I got to mile 70. There was still a bunch of race left over. I'm like, hey, I signed up for 70, so I should be done, right? No, I still had 4+ miles up a hill, and it was hard. And I pedaled my little heart out. And that last 2 miles, I was like, I get it. In life, you have to keep pedaling. You're gonna have flat tires. Even when you had brand new tires, brand new wheels, you checked everything, the air pressure, you did everything right, you're still gonna have flat tires. And you need to get the tire fixed and get back on your bike and keep pedaling. So when I crossed that finish line at 74.9 miles, I'm calling it 75, I was like, oh, I am so hungry. And my kids were like, you totally finished. You weren't first though. And I'm like, yeah, my goal was just to finish. And I wasn't sore the next day. And I could hardly sleep that night because I did something completely out of my comfort zone that I never could have done the year before. But I did all the work. And I learned a ton. I learned a ton about never giving up. I learned a ton about people who stopped, husbands who stopped, not my husband, other husbands who stopped to help. And I said, hey, I'll pay you. I kept giving them my card. And they said, no, it's such thing as road karma. Because I had two tubes and I used them both. And this guy gave me the third tube. And at the lunch break at 55 miles, the two race guys took my bike and took the wheels off and the tubes out and completely submerged it in water. And I was like, who are these people? I'm like, please let me pay you. No. We want you to win. I came home that day a champion, not because I did anything special, but because I did something hard that was outside of my comfort zone, and I learned a ton. So I challenge you to look at things inside, outside your comfort zone and start doing them, especially if you want to get your ham radio license. It's not super hard. Okay, what if we looked at risk as a venture? What if we looked at it as a daring journey or undertaking that we absolutely could do? What if we embraced our challenges? What if we said, who cares if I fail? What if we learned, who cares? My mother, very proper, love her to death, but she's worried too much about what other people think. What if we said, who cares? I messed up, who cares? I had fun, who cares? I went roller skating, fell on my butt 10 times, who cares? I had a great time. What if we said we're gonna learn from our challenges? Okay, so you know what this is? Have you ever seen this live? It's the Sistine Chapel. When I took my family to Normandy, we also went to Italy, and it was such a grand adventure. But we went to see the Sistine Chapel. It's magnificent. If you ever have a chance, you've got to get there. So Michelangelo painted this when he was in his 30s, and it's so spectacular. And when he was 87, he said, I'm still learning how to be a master at this. And so he was always a student. He was always learning. He could sculpt, he could do everything because he was always teaching himself. He painted this on his back. Like I was in there going, I couldn't do this. He had a love and a passion for this. So don't let things stop you. The things you need to ask yourself is, what's the worst thing that could happen to me? And can I survive it? Right? I promise you, you can survive it. After everything I did to beat cancer, I know I can survive it. People bring me problems, they're like, yeah, you know, I've got this hurt back, and I'm like, I beat cancer, right? You can never beat me, right? Because I did something really hard. And it gives me this strength and this fiber that I value. I'm so attached to my scar tissue now because I learned a ton. Okay, do you know what this says? Fortune favors the bold. People aren't lucky. Luck favors the prepared. Luck favors the people that will take a risk. My boss from years ago said, you're so lucky. Like everything just happened your way. And I'm like, yeah, I'm predictably lucky, aren't I? Like all the acquisitions that I picked, they end up being great acquisitions. Well, I didn't just pick them out of a gumball machine. I did a ton of work and I did all the homework and I did all my math and I got a lot of smart people in the room. And he's like, oh, I get it. You're not really that smart. I'm like, you know, I might not be, but I know how to find good people to help me. I know how to learn from other people. I know what it means to be a rookie. And part of my DNA says, I got this. I got this. When I go into a test, I got this. My ham radio test, I didn't miss a single one because I spent hours studying. I got this, okay? Now, when I speak to young people, a lot of times they're like, oh yeah, you're like a big deal and everything's easy for you and you know, you're born with this natural talent. Not the case. But for those of you who feel like you have zero talent and you're just not gonna make it, here's my list for you. These are the 10 things that you can do today to differentiate you from the mass of humanity. It takes no talent to be on time, okay? These are things that you can do. You work hard, you have a great attitude. I have some, in my company I was at before, I had an employee there was nothing special about, but they had a great attitude. And that guy hustled. And I gave him projects that were cherry projects because he had a great attitude. Being prepared. So many times people show up to their life, they're not prepared. So if you feel like, I don't have any talent, I can't do any of these things, guess what? Every one of you can do these things. And I'm sure you've seen these before. They're posted all over the place. But think about, look, what if I had a better work ethic? What if I worked harder than the guy next to me? What if I hustled more? And then finally, if I can get you to change your lens, to understand that nothing is hard for me, to embrace disruption, to be okay outside of your comfort zone, to pay attention to that voice inside of you that says, go for this, I promise you, you'll be happier, you'll be healthier, and you will have the most wonderful life, because I feel like I'm one of the most blessed humans on the planet. So I'm happy to take questions because we have a little bit of time, and the professors told me you get super agitated if you don't get out of here on time. No questions too hard, and please ask me for a question, because remember, nothing's hard for me. Now I'm gonna get a really hard question, like a calculus equation to solve. Thank you. We've got some celebrities here today. So we have Coach Nixon from the UVU women's basketball team, raise your hand, and Anthony, her other coach. And then we've got some players over here. These guys, if you haven't seen them play, you're missing out, because these girls played Seattle U last Saturday. This is a team of really fat, heavy women, and they dominated the floor. It was a tough game, but these guys were fun to watch, and I'm so proud to be a mentor of student athlete Leah Harvey, who's the center, 6'1". She's getting her butt kicked by this really fat girl, Wilma, but she held her own. So what questions do you have?
Okay, we're here with microphones. Speak up. And your son's here too. Did you introduce
yourself? This is my son, Strom Clark. He's an applied physics and neuroscience student at BYU. He speaks Chinese. He is pushes me every single day to learn and to grow. And I'm just so delighted that he came and spent some time with us today.
Yes, sir. Put those 10 points up again.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
And everyone can be good at this, you guys. Everyone. They're like, she's talked too much. We don't want to hear any more from her. Any questions? Yes, sir. Go Cougs.
Yeah. So where would you start? Where would you say to look at your life and to see how to change your aspect on that, on making sure it's not hard?
So I think the first thing is to be really aware of your response to things. Because a lot of times we're really good at covering stuff up, right? So what you don't know about me is I was paralyzingly shy as a teenager. To stand up in front of people is terrifying to me. I know that. So I took speech at BYU when I was a student there. And I said to the bishop in my ward, hey, if a speaker never shows up, doesn't show up last minute, just call me out of the audience. Oh, it's terrifying, right? But nothing's hard for me. So I have some things prepared. So I put myself in situations that I know I hate, because it helps me to get better. So I'm an extreme introvert, but I've learned how to communicate. So pay attention to the things that you hate. If it's talking to girls, that's not your problem, I'm sure. If it's conflict, so my husband doesn't like conflict. And I'm like, dude, this is gonna stop you. So learn how to have crucial conversations. Learn how to say to someone when you think they're wrong, I'm not convinced. It's a lot better than saying you're wrong. Right? Learn how to navigate the things that you feel uncomfortable with. I'd start with that.
Assuming you had a mentor, who was your most influential mentor, and what were three attributes that you really liked in them?
So I've been blessed to have a lot of mentors. And by the way, the mentor doesn't just open up an Easter egg and you're right inside of it, right? You have to go find your mentor. You have to go find people that piss you off. They're the best mentors, okay? So this woman I hated working for her because she was evil. And I decided, I don't want to be her ever. So I asked her to be my mentor, right? She took it as a compliment. I was like, okay, I'm gonna learn some really good things. But a mentor is someone who not only opens a door for you, but shoves you through it, okay? So one of my mentors was Greg Butterfield. I had an opportunity to take the CMO job at Symantec. I was like, no way, no way, no way. And he not only opened the door for me, but he shoved me through it. He's like, hey, if you don't take this job, 600 people are going to lose their jobs in Utah. I was like, oh. I didn't think I could do the job. You know what? I did the job. I learned a ton, and it was amazing. So find your mentors and find people that aren't you, that you might rub you a bit, and then learn from them. And you can actually learn from everyone, but it's good to have someone that you can bounce things off with that's going to push you to where you're uncomfortable. Yes, sir.
From your experience in the corporate world to your experience with startups, do you think there are different set of skills necessary for each realm? And if so, what would they entail?
The reason I include this list of 10 things is because these are things that are going to serve you in everything that you do. So I've worked in corporate, I've worked in startup. People say, oh, she's a big company girl. Oh, no, she's a little company girl, because I took a job as a CEO of a very small startup. You need to be resilient. You need to not be afraid to make mistakes. And to me, there's just different size of problems in companies that are large or small, but they still have problems. There's still opportunity for growth. And one thing, I always hire for fit, not necessarily skill set. So if you're going to a startup and you have someone like me and you like may not have the right skill set, but you can do these things and you can figure things out and you're not afraid to be a rookie and you're capable and smart, you're not afraid to make mistakes, then you'll do well in both organizations.
Okay, more questions. I was going to ask you, when you're in charge of so many employees, how do you leverage their skills and talents, how do you get them out of their comfort zone to really kind of push the ball forward?
So when one of the things my team learns about me is that I only do things that only I can do. So if you bring me a problem, you're like, oh, we got this problem with a survey. And I'm like, do you need me to fix it? Because then why do I need you? They're like, nope, I got it, right? Because too many times managers, leaders, they just want to fix it instead of pushing back. So we enable weakness across the organization. So my team understands everyone has a job, and the person who can make the decision, you got to push that down to the lowest level. If you ask me to make a decision, it better be that I'm the only person that can make a decision. So you need discipline to do that, and you got to trust your people. I err on the side of trust. I tell them, look, I trust you to figure this out. If you mess it up, I'm going to beat you, but you'll survive it. And you'll learn a ton. And you'll teach the rest of us. But it's your responsibility. And so what it creates is an organization where they trust each other. We enable each other to do really good things and to do really great things. And it's very efficient to get things done that way. But you got to trust your team. And if stuff moves up to me, then I know I have the wrong people. I should only be deciding things that are years out for the most part. No questions from women? Come on. Y'all got to throw me something. What about my team? They're like, oh my gosh, we play basketball. We don't want to ask a question. Think of a question. Okay, what about over there?
Okay, way over there. While he's going up there, how do you connect that also to the customer acquisition and the customer experience associated with your enterprise?
So customer experience is a big part of my past. The company has to have a passion for customer experience. You have to care about the customer. You have to make sure that everything you're doing is making it easy for customers to give you their money, okay? Make it easy for customers to complain to you, that you're putting yourself in the seat of the customer. Too many times companies, they decide what your customer experience should be, but they're not on the other side of it, right? So all of you have had terrible customer experience. I promise, it's probably with your TV provider, your home internet provider, your cell phone provider. There are service providers that don't give us service because they don't put themselves in the position of us. When I walked into my own cell phone provider store, I've been a customer for 30 years. I have all these advices, I have all my employees. I walk in there and they're like, what's your number? And I'm like, you can find my phone when I can't find my phone, right? So how come you can't say, Mrs. Clark, we're delighted to see you today. You only come to the store to get a brand new iPhone. We have one already ready for you with all your contacts on it. Why can't they do that? They can do that. Too many companies don't put themselves in that spot. So if you say, I'm gonna be a customer experience person, a practitioner, you're gonna be unique in your company. You're going to be valuable to your company because too many companies don't do a good job of taking care of customers. Gentleman with the mic. And then I need my girls to ask a question.
I wanted to delve a little more into, you said find a mentor, someone like you don't get along well with, very well. I wanted you to
someone that you don't naturally, are not naturally attracted to, right? Someone who's not, so not necessarily someone you don't get along with, but someone who's not like you. Someone who's different than you. And you can find people that you, I want to be like that person, but I think you learn more from someone that you're like, I don't want to be like that person, right? This woman that I didn't want to be like, I actually ended up liking her a ton because I understood her better. I understood that she was cranky all the time because she was in a man's world, technology, and she got no respect. So I thought of a different way to respond instead the way she did, but she'd been at it a long time. She was a lot older than I was. You can learn from everyone. Shout out my question.
Leia has it.
Leia. Leia's my student athlete. She's 6'1" and she's so bright. What's your question?
So my question, well, kind of all of our questions.
The team question.
Yeah, team question. Is deciding on majors and deciding on like how or what do you want to do?
Okay.
Do you have any thoughts on that?
Work with a lot of young people, they're like, I don't know what I want to be when I grow up. I thought I wanted to be a trash driver, but I really don't see that as my future, right? So you don't have to decide what you want to do when you start your career at school. You need to try a bunch of classes. But make a list of things you know you don't want to do. My list, don't work with pets, don't work with small children, don't work with people I really don't like, right? That was my list. So I ended up not becoming a math teacher that I thought I wanted to be. I work in technology, I work in marketing. So you don't have to decide today, but try a bunch of things and pay attention to what you like and what you don't like, okay? You guys have been great today. Thank you so much.